Well, do you get to be Hamish or do you get to be Jack?
That's
because
a very
you have to do both.
Yeah.
There
we go. Nice. That was a treat right there. Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of cameras. I'm just going to look at all of you. How about that?
So what can you tease us about season two?
Well, first of all, I'm a cage fighter, and no.
wow.
Yeah, a bit of a sharp right turn there. What can I tease you about season two? We've already established this universe, which I think is really cool. I fell in love with this project the moment I read the script. I thought it was so incredibly funny, so relatable. It's kind of self-aware in the way that it makes these references to pop culture, what's going on in today's world. It's not afraid to ever go for the punchline in a scene, which I think is really cool. It keeps it, there's this feeling of, you know, you never get too mired or bogged down in the dark, magical drama of the whole thing, and people are getting murdered and disemboweled and all this grisly stuff. But just to read a script where they're never afraid to just like swing for the fences and go for the play the comedy, it was incredibly refreshing. Just from a standpoint of like reading, getting a first script, and getting your initial impressions of the script. I'm really excited. What's very cool, I think, about this universe is there's so much ancient history to it. There's so much like a feeling of antiquity, like this struggle between, you know, the Order and the werewolves, who are sort of there to sort of regulate the magic, not necessarily stop the magic, but kind of like he says, I think in episode 3 or 4, it's like we're the cops, we're like magic cops. You know, we go out, we bust some skulls, and you know, we're not exactly the good guys here, but just the potential. And it felt like in season one we kind of just scratched the surface of it. Mm-hmm. Like there's this giant ocean that we could potentially dive into with the history. I mean, what was it like back in, you know, the Middle Ages when the knights were running around and the Order were up to their thing, you know, or the Renaissance, or, you know, the Industrial Revolution. You can imagine there was some kind of crazy, you know, I mean, that in itself would be a series. And so I'm really excited for us to hit the ground running with season two. The world is established. The characters are all established. We're going to go deeper in the history of the characters, hopefully the history of the universe. And what I think is very cool, for about half of the show in season one, it felt like there were these two worlds, the Knight's world and the Order world, and they were very much distinct from each other and kind of isolated from each other. We operated in secrecy, so did they. We weren't exactly aware of each other's presence. Now, I mean, we've been magically, you know, whatever, the Men in Black Flash thing, which, you know, seems to only be like a temporary solution to things. It's not a permanent fix. So I'm going to be very curious. I'd be surprised if we weren't aware of each other's existences. And I think from day one, if that's the truth, then the potential to get into some really interesting conflict, storytelling, different relationships. I am so incredibly grateful for my cast, because they, like, I come from a theater background, and I'm incredibly thankful for all my training and everything that and where it's gotten me, but I was pretty damn nervous. I'd never done 8 episodes as far as a character arc before, and I'm not gonna lie, I was pretty nervous, pretty tense, you know. He's kind of a reserved guy too, so there's a danger there, and you know, you play it a little too stoic, a little too cold, and there's not really too much going on. But just to have actors like Debris and Jake and Adam there, who are making these big choices, they're making bold choices, they're coming up to the writers and they'll go, hey, what do you, I'm going to do it this way, but what do you think if I do it this way the next time? And about halfway through filming the show, it was like I just took a breath, you know? And I went, oh my gosh, like, and I think I found some of my own Thomas-ness and was able to bring that to the table. Had a little bit, started to have fun with the characters, started to take the pressure off of do the good acting, you know, do the right acting, do it good, and more into the realm of like exploration, failure, and not afraid to make choices that don't. I remember there was this great moment where we throw Jack in the basement and we're trying to figure out whether to kill him or not, and we were having some drinks and whatever, and we walk into the room after making our decision, and Shelley, one of the writers, goes on the second take, she goes, all right, that's awesome, it's good. I need you drunker, all right? I need you to turn up the drunk. And I go, here's what I think about Hamish and his drinking. I go, I think he only appears drunk you know, because he's always behind the bar, he's always mixing the drinks, he's always in control of the flow of the liquor, and he's always winning the drinking games. So if you're good at drinking games, generally you don't get that drunk, you know what I mean? The purpose is to get the other guy drunk. So I had this whole theory that really it's more of a control thing. You know, he likes to control the alcohol because he likes to control the room. He likes to control the situation. And if he's in control of the situation, people don't die. And I think that's what he's really afraid of, is losing someone else that he cares about. So I go, I give her this whole thing. I'm very proud of myself, you know, in this moment. And Shelly goes, that's not the character we're writing. So, which, you know, to be honest, doesn't really change much in terms of the performance. You know, you just, you take the note and you do it. You turn up the drunk a little bit. It's like a thermostat. You just kind of, you go, okay, this, you want a little bit more of that? No problem. You dial it up. But to just feel like I had a responsibility to bring something to the table was an incredible feeling. And then the learning experience of... you can't be too precious about these ideas at the same time. You need to be willing to be like, you know, if it doesn't work in that moment, it's no problem. But there is a responsibility, I think, in terms of you got to be the expert on this particular guy. And if you're not, you don't deserve to do it, as far as I know.
There's a lot of humor, especially with the bar scenes. And I'm curious to know, do you have any wiggle room for improv? Because I always find Adam is such a goofball. It seems like a lot of his stuff seems improv.
Yeah.
So I was curious to know.
Yeah, they created this incredible environment, this atmosphere of play, exploration. They were all very respectful with the lines, respecting the writers, but just feeling like we were free to make mistakes and to try things was just the most amazing feeling. It took the preciousness out of it and just allowed us to explore and experiment and have fun. And I think it reads in the show. Yeah.